Mighty Ape is Australia's entertainment and pop culture superstore, with everything from movies, music, games, toys, books, hobbies and more. Mighty Ape is your one-stop shop for the things that matter most. They constantly have hot deals and exclusive promos. And if you visit their website on the click-through banner on fakeshep.net's homepage, then your purchase will help support Good Movie Monday. Mighty Ape, Australia's entertainment and pop culture superstore.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You mean to wish me a good morning? What do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me sleep for the love of God!
All right, boys. Stepping into this one hard. That's the sound of rummaging through a tool shed, I reckon. Just absorb that for a sec. Do you reckon you know what it is?
Is it a hip hop song?
No.
New metal? Is it new metal?
It's metalish.
It's metalish.
It's actually the title intro music for the movie The Collector.
Oh, The Collector. Yeah, right.
Yeah,
okay, cool.
That batshit crazy film that's basically Home Alone meets Saw.
Loved Collector.
Actually, that script was pitched as a prequel to Saw originally.
Right. Yeah, no, it was good. Yeah, because it's the same screenwriters that did some of the Saw films.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
But why The Collector? Well, that's because we are all collectors, and today we're going to be talking about movies that we recently collected. But first things first, I hope you're well. Welcome to another episode of Good Movie Monday, the weekly podcast presented by fakeshep.net, home of the Nerdy Cinematic Ramblings. And when I say we are all collectors, I mean us. My name is Glenn Cochran, and I like to collect bouncy balls from coin slot machines. And, of course, my co-host is the ever-reliable collector of fetish magazines, Ben Hellwig. Hey, mate.
I'm Jugs. I'm as good as Jugs.
And joining us once more, live at the desk, is Jarret Gahan, who collects spores, molds, and fungus. It's rad to have you here, mate.
Thank you very much, and I brought some samples to share with you later.
He's growing one in my belly button as we speak.
It's shaping up nicely, Ben.
The smell is getting weird.
It's funky. And thank you for listening. Good Movie Monday can be found wherever you get your podcasts from, platforms like Podbean, iTunes, Spotify, the iHeart Radio Network, amongst others. We have a bunch of important brands who support the show, and they would be Eagle Entertainment, Umbrella Entertainment, The Lunar Drive-In, Astor Theatre, and Four Pillars Gin, who all provide us with products and services that you guys can enjoy via our giveaway. So keep listening, because we have a mammoth giveaway for you later in the show. Another reason to keep listening is because we have our regular weekly updates from Screen Realm, the Sydney-based entertainment website, Adam Ross from the Australian Film Critics Association, and Bonehead Weekly, the twangy stylings of the three Kentucky rednecks. It's going to be a fun show, so let's jump straight into it.
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
First, guys, before we talk about collecting and stuff like that, it's been
who's
out for...
died?
Oh, well, we'll get to that too. But so what's been out for a few weeks that we haven't talked about yet is Zack Snyder's Justice League. I wanted to see if you guys have checked that out yet.
Admittedly, I know that it goes for, I think, 4 hours and 24 minutes or something.
Yep.
And I thought, wow, this is unprecedented. You've got a film that was released and then, you know, they've allowed the original director to go back, recut it, reshoot some stuff, release it. And I'm like, this is like the first time something like this has really ever happened. And I was kind of looking forward to watching it. But then I realized they had done it. They did it in 2004 with The Exorcist The Beginning and Dominion, a prequel to The Exorcist. So what I did was, for the very first time ever, I watched both of the films back to back. I'd never seen them. 17 years later, I watched both the films back to back.
Very different films.
Very different films. But admittedly, I actually quite enjoyed The Beginning more than Dominion.
You like the Rennie Harlan
version. Rennie Harlan redo I enjoyed more. But I did like both of them, and I appreciate them for their own merits. And I actually think they're... maybe 17 years has given a good passage of time.
I do agree.
I think they're quite good films. Like, what they are, they're pretty good. Except for those hyenas in both versions.
Yeah.
They look terrible. CGI central.
Because they did it with Payback as well, but it was the same director.
Oh, yeah, that's true, yeah.
They allowed him to go back and do it.
Because Mel Gibson said, no, I don't want to kill
the fundamental
I don't want the dog dying.
Fundamental difference here being $70 million extra put into this, right?
Ridiculous.
But what was that, just in grading and...
No, they went back and filmed the film.
Yeah, they went back with The Exorcist. It was like 90% of the film. Like, they brought Rennie Harlan in as a consultant. They said...
No, we're not talking about...
Oh, we're talking about this? No,
Snyder Cut.
Well, this, funnily enough, is exactly the same, because they spent an extra... They spent $65 million on The Beginning. And the other one was about $35 to $40 million. So it's a similar sort of, you know, precedent. Yeah, but they brought Rennie Harlan back and said, what can we do to this movie? You know, what can we do to fix Paul Schrader's film? And he goes, nothing. You need to reshoot the whole entire thing. Are you interested? And he goes, yeah, I'll do it. And then he said, yeah. So we shot 90% of it. It cost $65 million.
Not knocking back anything these days.
No, no, no.
They're not beating down his door to direct episodes of CSI Miami.
No, this, and of course, this is all post Cutthroat Island, where, yeah, I don't know if he'd had a gig between Cutthroat Island and Exorcist at the beginning.
So. This was like supposed to be his kind of return.
Yeah. So there you go. So that's what I watched instead of Justice League, but I've been meaning to do it. Well, have you watched it?
I have watched it. And look, it is a fundamentally different film. It is much better. I still don't think it's particularly good, but it's easy to watch. It is easy to watch.
Is it better than Batman versus Superman Dawn of Justice?
Absolutely. Good. But what got me about this is that he filmed this for IMAX, right? So instead, it's gone straight to streaming. But that means it's essentially in 4.3 ratio.
So
I feel like we've lost the image. Because you watch it and it's like, okay, this was like a VHS from the 80s. Yeah. Your eyes want to fill the gap on the side.
Yeah.
You don't care about what's up the top and bottom.
No, of course.
So it felt like a massive step backwards for this big budget film and we get like a bloody pan scan.
Well, I did read that he goes, oh, well, I thought, you know, you look at someone like Superman and he's towering and you want to see all of him in frame. And I'm like, just pull the camera back a few inches, mate. You can get more on the left and right, and you can get Superman from top to bottom. Dude, easy solve.
I was fixated on that fact. I just couldn't comprehend why on screen we've got this, you know, 4.3 kind of ratio.
It's bewildering. It's bewildering because it seems
Academy
like
ratio.
It sounds like a Wes Anderson move.
Yeah, 4.3 is Academy ratio.
Yeah,
right.
It was pre-widescreen,
I
think they need to update those Academy rules. Just a minimum of 177 to 1 and, you know, down to 240.
So, plus different ethnicities.
Yeah.
Right. But when I think back to 90% of the movies that I love, I watch them all as 4.3.
Yeah, totally.
Like,
I've never seen Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi, the original cuts.
Yeah.
In anything but 4.3.
Plus, what?
Right, okay.
Like the original version.
Yeah, of course.
Plus, the only difference being, obviously, we love widescreen, but the widescreen difference is just space. Right, because still what you're watching is what would have been center of frame anyway.
Of course, right.
It doesn't make a lot of difference.
Like the was it the Umbrella release of Ambulance?
The Eric Roberts Ambulance?
The Eric Roberts, Larry Cohen film. The print that they used, they removed the gates.
So it's more information. Full frame. Yeah.
So they hadn't gone back and actually put the... So you see stuff that you're not supposed to see in the top and bottom of the frame that they never intended you to see.
Of course, yes.
But you're like watching it. And it was only... The first time I watched it, I didn't notice anything.
And then
once I found that out, I was like, oh, really? I went back and watched it. And I'm like, this is quite distracting. Like all this extra shit at the top and the bottom. Like I'm just not used to it being there.
Of course. Like I remember watching these movies growing up as a kid on VHS where they were full frame and not pan and scan. Generally comedies and that. And you would always laugh. Oh, the boom's in shot. Oh, there's a shadow. Oh, I can see like the edge of the set. And you thought it was all, you know, this is all obviously a mistake. But the fact was it was full frame. It was never intended to be viewed that way. It was always going to be cropped down to theatrical ratio. But I don't know. 4.3 is just bewildering. And the fact that I had to stream it through Binge, which I love Binge, but admittedly sometimes my stream buffers a bit.
Yeah, right.
So I'm like, oh, I might just wait for it to come out in 4K.
Yeah.
But I feel like I should pay $20 if they're only going to give me 4.3. Like, I mean, $30.
The exposition is fantastic. Right. But I'm glad we sorted that out.
Excellent. Is there more Cyborg? Because,
he's got a backstory now.
Okay, well, he'll be happy about that then.
Yeah, he will.
he can back off from Josh Whedon for a bit.
All of those minor characters have backstories.
Right.
And it's broken into 6 parts. It's 4 hours long in 6 parts. But anyway.
It sounds very arthousey. 4.3 and it's broken into 6 chapters. It runs for 4 hours and 24 minutes.
I'd just rather watch Dawn of the Dead again.
I agree. I'll watch Sucker Punch probably one more time before I get to this one.
Anyway, one thing we've kind of adopted on this show is the Celebrity Death Watch, which I believe was coined by you, sir.
Might have been.
Used to be a respectful segment.
we're sitting here waiting for Betty White.
This
segment is just a ticking clock for you, Betty. I know you listen to the show.
It's a long weekend.
We don't have to do much of a whip around. The only person I can tell that has passed away was Larry McMurtry, the author of Lonesome Dove and Last Picture Show, Terms of Endearment, Brokeback Mountain.
Wow.
Yeah, 84 years old.
Wow.
So, you know, he was at that end.
Yeah.
So, not a shock, but sad nevertheless. But
is it because of the COVID vaccine?
No, but like people's skin are starting to flay, and you know, people are starting to
Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I know in Victoria or in Melbourne, at least, they're making the AstraZeneca vaccine in Parkville and Broadmeadows. And that's in Broadmeadows is where they make the best ice in Victoria also. So I just hope they don't mix them up and end up giving ice to the oldies. And we just got like, you know, urban crime committed by the elderly.
No, I think it's a sign that everyone is committed to getting through this pandemic. They've converted the ice labs to AstraZeneca labs. Yes. They're like, it's just guys in gumboots and aprons.
Yeah, yeah.
There's RVs in every neighbourhood.
Yeah. I can kind of see that scene from New Jack City where you've got all the topless women that are doing making the cocaine, but they're making all the AstraZeneca vaccine.
That's right. They're also wearing gloves.
Yes. And masks, of course.
Though they're having problems because you have to keep it under a certain temperature, whereas the cocaine can be cut and heat, so the nudity is okay. Whereas these guys, like they're freezing. Cold storage.
Yeah.
But they've got to be naked because just in case they try and smuggle some out.
Of course.
Well. So anyway, the theme of this this episode is collections and recent purchases and things like that. I was looking online at things people collect and back scratches and umbrella covers and sugar packets.
Really? People collect the back scratches?
Yeah. Banana stickers?
Banana stickers.
The stickers that go on bananas, but not the apple ones, just the banana ones.
Yeah, just the banana ones. Yeah. I like that they're so specific.
Yeah.
Just the bananas.
That's right. Yeah. So I think we're on the cool side of the collectors.
Back scratches. Yeah. Can you imagine how cumbersome it would be to collect those things? They take up a lot of room.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of room.
I kind of feel like as the PE teacher of this show that you've got an advantage on, us here. The upper hand.
Oh, Lord.
Anyway, I get gifted stuff more than anything. So perhaps why don't we just start with one of our most recent purchases, talk about them for a little bit, and then we can throw it over to Guillermo before we dive into the rest. I'll go first. I was recently gifted the Akira 4K, which hasn't quite been released yet, but I had to write an article for it. So I was gifted that. It's a delicious little package. Yeah. Like, this film has been given the re-release treatment many times over, but it's never looked better.
Yeah.
It's got a nice little case. It's got a booklet with, you know, full production information and interviews that have never been done before. But Akira is such a great film. Do you guys love
it? Yeah. I don't like many anime movies in this day and age, but Akira is still up there as, you know, I think it transcends anime. And is like a film on its own. I think it's fantastic.
Particularly the final act is like batshit crazy, and it's sort of it's about 100 films you can identify within that 20 minutes of a film. Yeah. But that's the most recent one I've been gifted, and definitely if you're into anime, it's worth picking up.
I've got to get that. Madman's putting it out. I mean, it's a bit pricey, but look, the package is amazing.
Well, it is, but it is pricey for what you get. You know, like it's stuff that's been on previous releases, and then I think most of the additional stuff is obviously the 4K aspect.
Yeah.
Plus the booklet.
Yeah.
But you know, if you're a fan and you haven't already got it, then definitely do. But,
I think it's definitely worth an upgrade.
All right.
Well, it's 4K. If it's got Dolby Atmos, I'm in.
Well, you know, you just have to. Yeah.
The quality of the film matters not.
No, I can't hear the words. I can't hear the words Dolby Atmos without thinking of this motherfucker.
Yeah. I bought shit that I wouldn't have even looked at on Blu-ray. But now it's got Dolby Atmos. I'm like, okay, sure, I'll give it another shot. 300? Sure, I'll give it another shot.
How bad can it be? Oh, that's not bad. But the sound is amazing.
So, Jarrett, you're up next. What do you got?
All right. Well, the first one I want to talk about briefly is Tales of the Uncanny. Now, this is a documentary we played at MonsterFest last year. And it's directed by David Gregory, who runs Severin Films, and produced by Kayla Janice, who used to be one of our festival directors at MonsterFest many years ago. Beautiful thing about this documentary is it was completely shot and produced during COVID.
Yep.
So a lot of the interviews have all been done via Zoom. There's some studio shot stuff because it was initially going to be a bonus feature on one of their anthology releases. I can't remember. I think it might have been The Uncanny. And then they kind of realized that they had more to work with and they weren't going to be releasing in a hurry, so they went, well, let's take full advantage of this pandemic and we'll talk to as many people as we can, whether they're like film scholars, filmmakers. I mean, there's so many people interviewed.
But their face is on screen.
Their face is on
screen. Because I watched the Belushi documentary the other day and there's no one on screen.
It's like the Supersonic documentary where it's all just audio archive stuff. Yeah, I know.
This was all phone interviews.
It's a great way to do a documentary.
Have you seen that You Don't Know Me?
I've got it. I haven't watched it yet. Yeah.
It's an excellent doco all on Showgirls.
Yeah.
It's a Talking Heads doco with no Talking Heads.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of the Belushi one.
It's all clips from the film with people talking over it. But you never once do you see any of the people that, actually talking.
Yeah. That annoys me a little bit. But you get these ones on Zoom.
It works really
well. Yes, these ones are. The funny thing is Brian Trenchard-Smith pops in there and I think he has probably the worst internet connection of everybody.
We know that for a fact.
Yeah, we do. Right?
I can't remember. Yeah. Does he plug his book?
No, because his book hadn't come out at the time, so he doesn't get to mention Ventures in a B-Movie Trade. But we just mentioned it for you then, Brian.
You're welcome.
But it's a solid doco, and the beautiful thing about this 7 release is it actually has two bonus films on there. So one of the earliest anthology horrors from 1919, a German one. I can't pronounce the title, I'm not even going to begin to. And then a French one from 1949, Unusual Tales. Oh, Eerie Tales, sorry, is the German one. That's the translation. So you don't only just get the documentary, you get the bonus films as well. But I really enjoyed it. I mean, you know, yes, you have to sort of be forgiving of the quality of the interviews, you know, the technical quality of them.
Okay.
But the information's fantastic. Yeah. And the thing I wanted to do immediately after watching it was track down every one of those movies. And thankfully, there's quite a bit of them on, like, Prime, you know, so I didn't have to go too far. But it documents everything. I mean, you're obviously going to touch on Creepshow and Tales from the Dark Zone, things of that, but it really delves to some more obscure made-for-TV stuff and that. But
and what was it called again?
Tales of the Uncanny, the ultimate survey of anthology horror. And that's it. It's more of a survey documentary than it is, you know, let's explore the origins, although they do.
But it's a shame for the people listening really that we don't film this.
I know, I'm just showing you guys.
You guys have bought, we've all got our movies here and we're holding them up, you know, for each other. But Ben, you're up.
Okay, well, first, I guess I will talk about Certain Fury, which is a Canadian film from 1985. I watched this again, like I've had the VHS for a while, but I just got the Kino Lorber Blu-ray, and I watched it the other night, and I put up, without any indication as to what the movie was, I just put up the opening scene, like the first, like a minute from one of the opening scene on Instagram, and I was inundated with messages of people going, "What the hell is this movie?"
Yeah. It's got a cool cover.
It does have a cool cover. It stars Tatum O'Neill and Irene Cara, and I think the promotion, the marketing at the time was that two Oscar winners in a in this area, and of course Tatum O'Neill had won an Oscar for Paper Moon when she was like 7 or 8. Or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
Irene Cara won it for best song in Flashdance.
Wow.
Not for acting.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was the marketing, and funnily enough, Irene Cara does have a nude scene in the film, which is quite odd and like totally gratuitous.
Particularly when you know her for an Academy Award from when she was very young.
But this movie is actually directed by Stephen Gyllenhaal, father of Maggie and Jake. And it is an unfortunate film because the opening, the movie starts with them, they're like a kind of reform school, a prison bus rocks up to the courthouse.
Right, right.
And it's all full of these women prisoners. Who are getting their first, it's the kind of the first, they've been held in detention, it's the first court case they're hearing to see what's gonna happen with them. And so they all get kind of trundled into the courtroom scene, and the first girl up starts singing, and the judge is trying to tell her to stop, and he's like, you know, bailiff, can you keep her quiet? The bailiff walks over to her, and she pulls a knife out of nowhere and slashes his throat.
Whoa.
And it's this old, like the bailiff is like this 80-year-old guy.
Wow.
Slices his throat, grabs his gun, and it is on. Like one of the most brutal courtroom massacre scenes.
I thought that was going in the direction of he got up and sung with her.
I was just hoping no one was going to get raped.
Yes,
I was like, this is going to be really bad. Where's this going? This is going to be horrible. This sounds amazing.
but it is great. Like the opening scene is great, and The girls who do it look or can be described, because everyone in the court is killed.
Mm.
So there's no survivors to say who the guilty parties were. They just see. So the only people who kind of escape are the two killers and Irene Cara and Tatum O'Neill. And they all go on the run. And first, the two killers actually end up being killed by the cops, but at different times by different cops.
Right.
We don't know the other one has been killed, so that they are convinced that it's Tatum O'Neill and Irene Cara.
Yeah, right.
And Irene Cara is kind of like a rich girl who's just, you know, got into a bit of trouble after her mum dies, and Tatum O'Neill is this street rat.
Yeah.
And kind of drug dealer. And then Peter Fonda comes into it and Moses Gunn, and there's all this kind of stuff. But the rest of the movie is quite a disappointment. And he even, to the point where there's lots of other kind of opportunities for gratuitous violence that happens off screen. Like he doesn't shoot, and you're like, but like, and like a lot of, they use the N word a lot.
right.
And like there's a lot of kind of, you know, dicey stuff.
Of its time.
That is of its time. Yeah. 1985, that kind of stuff was okay, I guess. or not. In Canada.
Yeah, in Canada.
In Canada, it was okay. But it's just really weird. It's just like, it's like they had this great idea for the start of the film, and then that was it. Like whoever pitched the idea was like, no, this happens. And then they just escape. And he's like, well, okay, but we need to make 90 minutes out of this. So
Describe
this. And it's like they just come up with something. So it is unfortunate. Peter Fonda, like, he was obviously just there for a day.
You're right. he's doing an Eric Roberts job. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and his name, Nicholas Campbell, who is in a lot of Canadian kind of TV shows. Like he's much older now. He's in his, would be in his 60s or 70s. He's in everything, playing like either the kind of the sheriff, the retired sheriff, or the main character's dad, or like the drunk who lives in a caravan. Like he's in everything. Because everything is shot in Canada now, he is in literally everything.
Well, I do want to see it just for the courtroom scene alone.
I'm sold on the artwork for it.
For you guys that are listening at home, strap in, you're in for a long one. We're already 20 minutes into this, and we haven't even thrown to our first segment. This is normally where we would throw to you, Jarret. In lieu of your PE segment, do you want to run through any new releases?
Look, yeah, I will. What I'll do is I'll condense it right down, and I'll only talk about the really
maybe just
key
name
ones.
Them. Don't even have to.
Okay, Umbrella are releasing Stone to Blu-ray as part of their Ausblutation Classics. Now it's decked out with special features, got a 4K, you know, new scan that was overseen by Sandy Harbutt before his passing, and it actually features the soundtrack as a bit of a limited edition as well.
Brilliant.
They're also releasing The Cook, The Wife, The Thief, The Bloody Lover, and Michael Dudikoff, as I like to say.
Yeah.
That's coming out on Blu-ray and DVD. That's part of, on Blu-ray, part of their Beyond Genres series. Big Night's coming out on Blu-ray, which I know you're excited about.
I love it. Went to the movies and
Glenn
saw that.
Saw it theatrically.
I can't believe that movie got a theatrical release.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic. It was huge when it came out. Like, it did big box office.
Because it announced Stanley Tucci and what's the other guy?
Campbell Scott
as the next big thing.
Yes.
Like, they were very much...
What's his name, isn't it? It's Stanley Tucci and Monk. Whatever his name is.
Yeah, yeah, Tony Shalhoub.
But these other two made the film.
They wrote and directed it.
Yeah.
But then Stanley Tucci would spend the next 20 years doing bit parts. But that's fine.
But also,
you know,
because...
Ever increasing.
But at that point in time, everything was Tarantino. And then suddenly it was this new wave of different filmmakers.
Yeah,
you know?
Cut through. But I'm excited about them when the final drive-in Delirium's coming out on Blu-ray called The Final Chapter.
But is it?
I think it is. We know the guys, and I think they're tapped.
I think they're just done.
They're tapped, yeah.
Because a lot of people don't know. It's not like they're waiting for HD versions of these trailers to come out to compile them.
Yeah.
A lot of the time, the HD versions don't exist.
They don't,
the trailers, and they are going shot for shot.
Yes.
And recutting.
And recreating.
And sometimes, like, if you actually go back and watch the actual original trailer, it is slightly different, because a lot of the time when they make trailers, they use footage before the final film is cut.
Sure.
So there's, like, different...
They use alternate shots
and stuff.
Things that were in the trailer that didn't end up in the feature.
Yeah, yeah.
But they do go to the effort of doing all the, you know, optical graphics of the titles and everything, so replicating that titles, aspect of it.
Awesome.
Time-consuming. Roadshow's putting out Promising Young Woman on Blu-ray and DVD. Very excited about that. It was one of my favourite films of... late last year, early this year. Universal Sony Pictures Home Entertainment putting out Let Him Go, which I actually quite dug. Kevin Costner, Diane Lane.
Yep.
Pretty cool film. And look, that, to be honest, that is the cream of the crop in terms of releases. There's Defiant, they're actually putting out a real unsung gem from last year called Hunter Hunter, and that's only coming out on DVD. And that one's got Devon Sawa in it. It's actually a really good role for him as well.
Two more I can add to that.
What else is coming out?
Smiley Face Killers, which is the Brett Easton Ellis wrote that one.
Yeah.
Wrote a screenplay for it.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Yeah, right.
And there's one, just because of the title, A Werewolf in England.
I saw that one pop up. Yep.
Where's he from, though? Where's the werewolf from?
They
always have to come from somewhere else.
Is he a Yang?
is he an American werewolf? Is he a French
vampire? No, he's a werewolf.
It's the perfect marketing. You must watch to find out.
Yeah, of course. There you go. Yeah, I'll definitely have to check out. I actually do want to check out both of those titles. So,
speaking of hairy creatures, here's Guillermo from Screen Realm.
What's happening, everybody? It's Guillermo here again from ScreenRealm.com, Australia's favorite entertainment website covering all things movies and television. Happy to be back on Good Movie Monday. I'm going to talk, first of all, about Godzilla vs. Kong. My review is up on the website right now. I gave it 3.5 out of 5 stars. I really had a good time with it. It's a fun monster flick, and it basically says what it's going to do on the cover. Unlike films like, say, Batman v Superman, which had around seven something minutes of Batman actually versing Superman, Godzilla vs. Kong has Godzilla vs. Kong on a huge scale. It's a massive film. It's dumb as hell as well. It's really, really silly. And unfortunately, the characters are really underwritten, and there's so many plot turns where you're just going to be like, what the hell? But like I wrote in my review, you're going to be saying, what the hell? But you'll have a big smile on your face as you do. The CG mastery on display is undeniable. Both Godzilla and Kong are more emotive than they have ever been previously, their expressiveness stopping just before they like actually speak. The VFX creations are wonderful and importantly convincing, and despite the shortcomings when it comes to character, some of that dialogue and how those people are maneuvered through the plot, Godzilla vs. Kong manages to be nevertheless a kick-ass monster flick. The action reaches appropriately jaw-dropping levels of insanity, and the technical wonders are fine-tuned for the maximum impact. See this one on the big screen or on the biggest screen and best sound system you have during this time. 3.5 out of 5 stars. You can check the full review out of ScreenRealm. Moving on to a couple of quick news stories, an adaptation of shooter video game franchise Sniper Elite is on the way. On board to direct the film is Brad Peyton, whose credits include Dwayne Johnson, Disaster Movie San Andreas, and monster movie Rampage. Peyton is also set to pen the screenplay with Gary Graham, who has written a still unproduced spec script titled A Garden at the End of the World, and he's also behind a planned reboot of Will Smith's film I Am Legend. As reported by Variety, the plot will follow an elite allied sniper, Carl Furban, engaged in a cat and mouse chase through the streets of London at the height of the Blitz during World War II, as he tries to save British Prime Minister Winston Churchill from a Nazi assassin. The film has been described as something between a Sherlock Holmes movie meets a Bourne Identity thriller, which is a combo that producer Jean-Julien Baronet says will make it stand apart from a film like Enemy at the Gates. And two sequels, count them, two sequels to whodunit hit Knives Out are heading to Netflix thanks to a huge deal. The streaming giant has paid a whopping $400 million plus to land the rights to two sequels to Knives Out, the 2019 hit, directed and written by Rian Johnson. Netflix took on other streamers to lock in the follow-ups, making it among the most lucrative movie deals in streamer history. Daniel Craig will be back as Benoit Blanc, the detective who was looking into the mysterious death of a wealthy patriarch in the first film. Rian Johnson will return to direct and produce the next two films, with producing partner Ram Bergman returning as well. Knives Out was a big hit, earning over $311 million worldwide from a budget of around $40 million. Casting on the still untitled Knives Out 2 is about to kick off, with filming set to begin in Greece on June 28th, so stay tuned on that one. When it comes to this week's theme, recent movie purchases, I'm afraid that I am pretty much out of this one. I can't remember the last film I even bought. I've been streaming everything and running a website. You know, you get sent stuff. Okay, well, maybe I got sent something cool. Let me have a look back here. Just looking at the shirt that's near my desk. I got given a Godzilla shirt at the premiere of Godzilla vs. Kong. I'm really lame. I really need to buy more physical copies of stuff. I've got a huge collection of Blu-rays and DVDs, but I haven't actually bought one in ages. This just made me realize that. Now I feel terrible. What right do I have in owning a movie website? Anyway, everyone, go check out ScreenRealm.com. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all that jazz. And we also have April streaming schedules for Netflix, Stan, Binge, Shudder, all that. Bookmark all our pages. See you later.
I'm a collector, and
There is another clanky song for you all. I've been looking for an excuse to put some Nine Inch Nails on the show, and that was The Collector from the With Teeth album. Of course, the title related to today's theme. Before that was Guillermo from Screen Realm. We love that guy. He's cooler than cool accent, and that was a good segment from him this week. You can visit Screen Realm at screenrealm.com. Visit their social media pages. They've got good shit, so support them and what they do, because in turn they support us. Guys, back to the recently purchased movies. Let's bump the next one off from our piles. Jarrett, do you want to scrape the surface?
Yeah, look, I've got Satan's Blood that recently came out on Vinegar Syndrome in the US. This is a Spanish horror, and it's directed by Carlos Puto, I think is his surname. Anyway, this is an interesting film. I had never seen it prior to this Vinegar Syndrome release. It has been out before on DVD, and it's really odd. It's like a satanic kind of cult thriller. And it's just so odd in that characters do things that you go, that seemingly would never happen. And it's a bit absurd at times, but for everything that's kind of like that just makes you scratch your head, it makes up in atmosphere. It is such an atmospheric and eerie fucking movie. I watched the first 20 odd minutes of it and I was like, oh, I'm not too sure about this. And then I sunk right into it. And after it finished, I actually watched it without my wife because I knew it was going to have some gratuitous sex. And I was like, oh, look, maybe I'll let her sit this one out. And then I finished
it. You're decent.
And then I went back. I think I went upstairs and I said, geez, that's Spanish film. It ended up being really good. And she goes, of course you watched the good one without me. How many bad ones have I had to watch that you said, I don't know. I don't know which way it's going to go. And it never goes good. But yeah, Satan's Blood. It's Vinegar Syndrome. So they do a 4K restoration of like the original camera negative, and it looks much better than it should. It looks better than studio films. This movie's from like the late 70s. But yeah, it's a really underrated gem.
How was the gratuitous sex?
Well, it was pretty good. There was full frontal nudity on both halves. So they, you know, you saw a bit of dong, you saw a bit of bush. It was the 70s, so it was very bushy. There was a lot of nudity.
To be fair,
I think you would have loved it.
His bush should have covered his dong.
It should have been, yeah. It'd be like
it was a snake poking out of the bushes.
A Velcro tussle session, essentially.
Yes. I really recommend it. Ben, have you seen that, Satan's Blood? Because if you haven't. That's an immediate purchase for you.
Great title.
I reckon you're really going to enjoy it. Yeah. All right. Yeah.
You'll have to tack it onto your next
Vinegar Syndrome. Yes, my next Vinegar Syndrome order for you. I will.
This is like a love fest. Ben, you're up next.
I mentioned it on last week's show when the wedding episode, when you mentioned the film Tag, and I did say I had just got Tag the Assassination Game on VHS, because I don't think it's had any other release.
I don't think it's had a DVD release.
I don't think it's ever come out on DVD.
He's brought it along so he can show all the listeners the video cover.
which I haven't bothered to clean up, so it still has its $3.95.
It's a dusty
but
clamshell.
I damn sure you paid a bit more than $3.95 for it, yeah?
I didn't pay that much for it, I don't think, like... 20, 30 bucks.
Oh, that's not. That's pretty good.
It wasn't too bad for a VHS tape these days.
Yeah, and in that kind of condition, nice.
With a lovely clam that's relatively undamaged.
You can hear it. Listeners can hear it.
You can hear it. That's it squeaking. It's tight. The seal is tight on that clam.
He's turning the listeners on. Tight like a seal.
Teenage Ben's parents would have been familiar with this sound if they ever walked past his
he's bedroom. Watching Tag again.
I told you not to come in my room when I'm watching Tag.
Oh, shit.
And this is, I'm not sure what, when was it? I'm not sure what the year was that this came out, but 82. But there was around that time, there were a lot of Tag-related kind of movies. It must have been a craze that swept mainly college campuses and stuff. Yes. There was Gotcha as well.
I love Gotcha with Anthony Edwards and Linda Fiorentino.
Linda Fiorentino, but that was much bigger in scope because he ends up going to East Germany.
Everywhere, all over Europe.
This one is set purely in a college campus and where they've got this game of tag run by this really kind of shonky character, but... Robert Carradine is tasked with he's a journalist on the college newspaper, and they wanted to do a story on it, and he's been rejecting it for a while, but then he spots Linda Hamilton, who is one of the kind of main players of the game, and he kind of immediately his pants get tight, so he agrees to do it and follows her around, but during first round of this game, the guy who's been the champion for the last like 3 years, who's obsessed with the game, and it's the guy from Bruce Abbott from Reanimator. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, cool.
In a really weird role. Like he's traditionally like a super good looking leading.
Cool guy.
A Bruce Campbell type.
Yeah. Yes. And in this he's playing like the pasty faced kind of slightly unhinged.
And Robert Carradine's the cool one, yeah.
And Robert Carradine is the cool one.
That's so surreal. 2 years later, he wasn't so cool.
Totally.
Haven't you seen Nerds 3? He's very cool.
Yeah, true.
Or that what's that? Is that the one where they're old?
Yeah, he's got a ponytail.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's the made for TV one, yeah.
Yeah, number 3 and 4.
Yeah.
With what's his name? Jefferson from Married with Children.
Oh yes.
But he gets knocked out by accident. This one of the his because every round you kind of just get assigned the person who you're versus, and then at the end of the round you submit who won that round, and there's a chart and you go.
Sounds fantastic.
And the first guy that he's up against accidentally falls over, and his gun hits the ground and shoots Bruce Abbott, so he's out the first round.
Right.
But he, because he's so obsessed and insane, then he actually refutes this and actually kills. Bruce Abbott kills the guy.
Oh, Bruce Abbott kills him. Right.
And then he realizes that there's like that's just what he's going to do.
Yes.
And so he spends the whole game killing all of the contestants that he's kind of up against, and no one else is really aware of this until kind of like halfway through, where Linda Hamilton like opens a closet door and literally finds a stack of mutilated bodies.
It's on the back of the VHS cover. On the cover. That's a sell for me.
Yeah.
Tell me this though. This is obviously a film they can't make this day and age. Yeah. You got a college shooter, campus shooter. Yeah.
Not allowed. And it's directed by Nick Castle.
This is his first film.
Wow.
Nick Castle's first film before Last Starfighter and Boy Who Could Fly. And,
well, that's on my list now.
Yeah.
For sure. It just sounds great.
You got to borrow this VHS. It's the last copy of it in the world.
I do believe you can watch it on YouTube.
I think it is. Yeah, you're right. I'm pretty sure it is on YouTube.
YouTube comes to my rescue all the time.
Yeah.
So, like you guys, I like to raid the op shops, buying some thrifty things. And for people overseas that don't know what an op shop is, it's a thrift shop.
Yeah.
I'm going to sort of do things a little bit differently here. At the end of the show, I'm going to get you guys to run through the rest of what you've got.
Right,
I'll do it now just so that I can save time then.
Yeah.
So, some that I picked up were Legal Eagles.
Oh, yes. Yeah, Ben and I had a mission for that. We bought it overseas in Texas.
Multiple times.
And I didn't get to watch it.
And I watched it while you...
I went to the festival we were there for. Ben stayed home and watched Legal Eagles. We're at Fantastic Fest.
They're going to Fantastic Fest to watch new movies. I'm like, I'm not interested in this. I'm just going to watch Legal Eagles.
Michael Helms laughed at us, but years later I'd pick it up for $1 and I would watch it.
Well, I picked it up for $3. also, The Doctor...
The Doctor with William Hurt?
Yes.
One of my favourite films. Yep. I fucking love that movie.
You can see there's a theme here at this particular op shop because then I picked up Dying Young.
And then I love Dying Young.
And then of course you do. And then
Campbell Scott.
Yeah, then I picked up Wit again. Wit, which is the one where Emma Thompson's dying of cancer. So
shit, you found Wit.
I did.
Oh, that's a good score for $3. I would have paid $8.
Someone has an erection over here.
Yeah. He's hit op shop gold.
I'm going to make eye contact with you because
he's lost all respect for me after I'm like Dying Young with Julia Roberts and Campbell Scott. Right.
Okay, let's see how flaccid we can make him now. So then I picked up The Changeling. I picked up Where Eagles...
Which Changeling? The George C. Scott?
George C. Scott one.
Oh, classic.
He's hard.
I don't mind the Clint Eastwood one.
Well,
haven't seen it. Danny watched it without me. And
I also picked up
now.
Hang 'em High as well. So there's an Eastwood one for you. Nice. Where Eagles Dare, there's another one.
Haven't seen it.
I watched that not too long ago. That's
picked
a great
up
movie.
Booksmart on Blu-ray. Which
I didn't enjoy that one.
Well, I wasn't going to buy that one for anything more than $5. I got it for $3.
$3 on Blu-ray. Good score.
I did enjoy the film.
Yeah.
The original Failsafe.
Yep. Not the one with Ryan Reynolds. Made for TV,
Ryan Reynolds Failsafe.
Yeah, there's one there. And
you don't mean the George Clooney one, do you?
No, the George Clooney one we saw yesterday on VHS and we threw it away. That was the that was the one that was broadcast live. They did it all in real time.
It's a great one.
No, there's another one just by title called Failsafe with Ryan Reynolds. Came out on Magna Pacific, the DVD.
All right. Then The Apartment, Cadillac Man.
The Apartment, the Jack Lemmon apartment.
Yes.
Fucking love it.
It's a great
one. Two more. Oh, three more, but I'm going to.
Hang on, what was that middle one?
Cadillac Man.
Oh, I love that.
Listen to this
Robin
guy.
Williams, Tim Robbins. What a movie.
I mean, I don't want to, far be it from me to act towards stereotype, but I do believe you get to see Friendrich's boobies in that one.
I'm pretty sure you do too, yeah.
That's The Nanny.
Then I got The Long Kiss Goodnight.
Chefs do that.
Chefs do that. Yes. And you're grounded. And Bonfire of the Vanities.
Bonfire of the Vanities. We threw that out yesterday. But I reckon that's a really underrated Brian De Palma film. I've even read the book, The Devil's Candy, which is all about the making of that movie and how much of a major
I just love the fact that we've got listeners with no context when he says, we threw that out yesterday.
Yeah, sorry, yeah. Ben and I did a VHS hunt yesterday and we came across 2,000 tapes, of which we kept maybe just over 100. We won't go through the specifics of how we disposed of the tapes, but I will say we got rid of about 1,900 tapes.
Oh, Jesus. Yes. Well, the one I'm going to stop on, because it's Easter, I picked up Resurrection, 1999 film, directed by Russell Mulcahy, starring Christophe Lambert. Yes.
The Blind Man.
And it only occurred to me now that it's like an Easter film.
Yeah.
Like I've never, we do all these festive films. We talk about Christmas films, and Easter, you always come up with Critters 2. It's the one that Critters you always 2. Come up with.
Peter
you
know. Rabbit now.
Yeah.
Bunny Peter Rabbit 2.
Yeah, that too. But Resurrection, it's all about rebuilding the body of Christ. I love this film. I have loved it since it got released. And it's sort of one of those films off the back of Seven that was a clone movie. But as I was telling you guys earlier, I think it kind of holds up much better than Seven in the context of just, you know, 20 or something years have gone by.
Yeah.
And it doesn't fall victim to the style of the 90s.
Right.
Seven
right.
does. Like Seven's still a superior film. It's a much better film. Yeah. But
is there a head in the box at the end of... Is Gwyneth Paltrow's head in a box at the end of Resurrection?
Spoiler alert. Bloody hell, okay.
But nobody's been cancelled.
If you haven't seen Seven by now, it's your own fault.
No one's been cancelled in Resurrected, if I'm correct.
But no.
But it's okay. Because he's the villain.
Okay, yeah. Well, that's true.
You're allowed to play the villain in
right, yes.
If you're some kind of a course.
Well, talk about a cast, though. Because other than Lambert, you've got Leland Orser, who is also in... Is it Leland Orser? I don't think that's his surname. Leland Orser. Yeah, from Seven. He was also in The Bone Collector. So he was kind of running and Very Bad Things. He was running that sort of dark gauntlet at the time. David Cronenberg's in it. He plays the priest.
Oh, shit. I can't even remember that.
And he's the only other movies he were in were Nightbreed and Jason X.
Yeah, well. Yes,
and Trial by Jury with Amanda Sarte.
Oh, and The Newsroom movie.
Well, with Resurrection.
No.
I was like, was he in that?
No. You remember that? There was that Canadian TV show called The Newsroom?
Yeah, it was like Frontline.
Frontline, yeah.
Oh,
it was like
right.
there's an episode where the nuclear power plant that's just like 10 miles up the road from this news station is going into meltdown and everyone's evacuating.
Yeah, yeah.
And David Cronenberg's the guest on the show.
He's playing himself, isn't
he? Playing
himself. Yeah,
he's
I have seen this.
There.
Yeah,
he's especially there for, I think, Crash. And he's like, look, I'm here to talk about my film Crash. I don't want to talk about Scanners.
Yes, like, yes, I do remember this.
And then literally they come on air. The guy turns to him and goes, so, how'd you make that head explode?
Yes, I remember that all too well, yes.
Well, as far as his performances goes, outside of Nightbreed, this is the most substantial.
Cool. Excellent.
And
Excellent. It's
a good movie. Like, it's dark, it's twisted, the cinematography's great, and I just highly recommend it. And I already had it on the Australian DVD, which I think Eagle put out, but it was a pan scan kind of course, transfer.
It was very early generation DVD.
Yeah, and but this, the one I picked up is widescreen on one side of the disc. Remember, you could flip the disc over.
Yes, of course.
It's got commentary, all that kind of stuff. So,
beautiful. Yeah, on both sides?
Yeah,
the commentary on both sides.
It does. It does.
Like, you can only watch the commentary on the
side. But if you turn it around, the commentary plays backward on the other side. Yeah. And you summon Christophe Lambert.
No, on the other side.
It's like Mr. Magoo in your living room. Oh, is that the TV? Sorry.
Welcome to the pan scanned commentary where you only get two-thirds of what I say.
This one is hosted by Zack Schneider.
Welcome to Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. Glenn has asked us to talk about our recent purchases. Chad tells me I should tell you about the Tums and the bourbon that I have bought. Now, it's probably not movie related, but I did drink some of this Saturday night. I was texting with you all and watched Freaky with Vince Vaughn. Is that movie related?
By the way, never mind.
What? Oh, so I recently had a birthday. A couple people sent me some nice things. James, thank you so much for the coffee. But someone sent me this horror blanket with all the different mass murderers on it that we all seem to love and worship. That was nice. I'm going to sit here and keep my legs warm during the show. Who's next?
James, go.
I don't I buy stuff. I did recently buy the 7% solution on Blu-ray special edition, but this is something I bought just for myself. Strange Caddish, which is a book that has Harlan Ellison, Neil Gaiman, several other people. Clifford Meth is has this, and what's kind of cool about it was
Clifford Meth.
He is an author. Yes, he's listed there. But this is actually from a collection he had, and it is conveniently signed by both him and Ellison. And I got that recently, as well as if you've never listened to the series, Run for the Stars. This is Harlan Ellison. He did a series of stories set during a obviously fictional war in space. They've been talked about adapting them into film several different times. Has not happened, but he did do an audio recording of it. I do recommend checking that out. So that's two things I bought for myself recently that could be films.
All right, Jed.
All right, so mine's not a film either. The last thing I purchased, I'm still awaiting to arrive in the mail. I am a huge animation freak. I love cartoons.
So what does that have to do with your mail order bride? And does she know you're already married?
She's a cartoon in a magazine, and we're getting married on Sunday. I love cartoons. I have a huge collection, and I also collect animation cells. And I was able to find a animation cell from Of Throttle from Biker Mice from Mars, which is an obscure cartoon that's basically a ripoff of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, because instead of pizza, they love chili dogs. So
the street sharks liked hamburgers, right?
Right.
Is there who liked corn dogs?
No one.
Yeah. Are you sure about the radioactive hamsters?
I just don't like corn dogs.
I'm not a big fan of corn dogs either. I do love chili dogs.
I like I like chili dogs and I like cornbread, but the two should not get together because that's Satanism.
And then put on a stick.
If Roger Corman made them and they called them Corman dogs, would you at least try one?
I would take a picture of one going in my mouth.
So yes, that is what he would eat it. So yeah, that's my purchase is an animation cell of Throttle from Biker Mice from Mars. I'm very excited to get it hung up on my wall.
This has been Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. Go out and buy me some shit for my late birthday. Yay!
You know, I think those guys have sort of they've woven themselves into the fabric of this show. Mm. I can't imagine Good Movie Monday without them. So much love to Joe, Chad, and James. And you can send your support directly to them by finding their podcast, Bonehead Weekly, wherever you get your podcast from. Theirs is a much longer format, obviously, and I highly recommend it. All right, we're going to, in the home stretch here, Ben, do you want to lead the charge on what you've recently purchased?
All right, so my last one is the, once again, Kino Lorber. I seem to have,
yeah.
their Studio Classics line is bringing out a whole bunch of awesome shit. This one, 8 Million Ways to Die, starring Jeff Bridges and Rosanna Arquette, and Andy Garcia and Alexandra Paul.
That's an incredible cast.
The very attractive Alexandra Paul turned up in this one. It's based on a Lawrence Block. I don't know if it's actually based on one of the books or it's the character in general. This character, Max Scooter, who's like a private eye type ex-DEA kind of cop who gets, you know, always mixed up in weird things in the book series. And this is actually the second series of books, I believe, that has been based on that Lawrence Block has yep. had turned into a movie, because he did Burglar, where they changed the character from man to woman.
That's right.
The Whoopi Goldberg movie. But this one, it's very much kind of in that kind of 52 pickup.
The Bobcat Goldthwait.
Yes.
I'm kidding. Depends which version, though, because the video cover and...
I know.
Sometimes he's on the back of the bike, sometimes he's not.
He's right. Another one I tried to reach out to recently.
Oh, man, he'd be great, yeah.
Not for the show, just tried to reach out to him.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so, I haven't heard from you for a while. How you doing? You all right, man?
Can we be friends?
Thanks for the ride. Yeah, thoroughly.
Best bit. So this, and I believe this is actually the last film that was directed by Hal Ashby.
All right, cool.
And it's a very, very much in that kind of To Live and Die in LA / 52 Pickup kind of vein, like a seedy kind of Los Angeles,
almost noirish.
Yes, very much, very much so. And he's like a ex-DA kind of alcoholic private investigator who's trying to get his shit together. And he kind of gets involved in this kind of...
How many movies have Ways to Die in the title? Like, there's been a few of those.
I'm sure there's a gazillion. And, like, it's pretty good. It's actually, like, a pretty decent kind of thriller. I was pleasantly surprised. I had not seen it before. I had the VHS tape for years.
Yep.
And never bothered to watch it. But I popped it on when this came up. I couldn't wait to see it. And it does actually... it's got a bunch of extras, which are great.
But we're not going to tell you what they are.
We're not going to tell you what they are.
You're going to have to find it.
Yeah. One of the good ones with Alexandra Paul. She does talk about how she in the scene. I can't remember. She's required to do nudity in the film, and she was like she was quite happy to do it because they had it for the rest of it. She's like playing like this kind of high priced kind of call girl. She's like, she thought she looked better nude than she did in the clothes that they put her in. So she
that's great.
Like, happy to do the nude scene.
That's terrific.
And it's just great because usually in extra features, they don't touch upon that kind of stuff.
They kind of
avoid it. And in this one, she's like, no, that's...
very open
about it. If only Kevin Costner felt that way in Robin Hood.
Yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to go next before Jarrett can bring it home. At Close Range, which is the James Foley film from 1986, part of the imprint series, starring Sean Penn, Christopher Walken. I think this is Christopher Walken's best film. I don't know if you guys would agree, but it's just terrifying. What a cast. It's a sucker punch of a film. Mary Stuart Masterson, Crispin Glover, Sean Penn, Stephen Jeffries, a.k.a. Ben, I'm sure you know his other name.
I can't remember.
Screen name.
Something Ritter. Is it something Ritter?
Yeah.
Cock Ritter.
He's also a gay porn star.
Yeah.
Kiefer Sutherland, David Strathairn.
Fraternity vacation.
I know, man. I don't know what more to say about this film. It is just a sucker punch of a film. I love it. There is the scene that really strikes me the most, if you've never heard the behind-the-scenes stories. Right at the end, there's a showdown between Christopher Walken and Sean Penn, and Sean Penn pulls a gun on Christopher Walken in the kitchen. And behind the scenes, Christopher Walken apparently is famous in Hollywood for having a fear of guns in general.
Wow.
And he has the safety inspectors go over the props really, really thoroughly to make sure that it is a prop gun, blah, blah, blah. And as they called action, Sean Penn switched it for a different gun. And then they kept rolling. So his reaction in the film is his actual fear of having a gun put to his head. Yeah. It was another prop gun, but it was just not the one that had been inspected.
If he wasn't accustomed to it and wasn't aware of it,
he's going to... So that scene, when you watch it with that in mind, is just absolutely something else. So
that's a great that's a great addition too. Imprint are doing some really good things locally.
But to think James Foley came from that, and then he ended up making the 50 Shades sequels and stuff like that. I know,
it's kind of sad, isn't it? It's sad when you see someone that's like a bit of a titan of cinema, you know, comes out and does these really important, great films of a period,
and
then now is relegated to directing...
I mean, he's still making a lot of money and he's being creative to some regards, but it's not the labor of love passion project.
You hope that the legacy is remembered for the body of work that came before, you know, needing to do the renos on the house.
That's
and, you know, get the kids into college sort of, you know, movies. But yeah, good to know that he's still working.
Yeah.
You know, that's
and it came at that time when there were other films similar like River's Edge and things like that where it was all this really gritty, grimy kind of
really gritty
teenage stories.
Period in time, that mid-80s to have those movies. Charlie Sheen did that one. What with Maxwell Caulfield, The Boys Next Door, was it?
Boys Next Door.
Yeah.
There's some many gritty films from that era and they're so good to watch because it's a stark contrast to the John Hughes stuff that was happening. And I love both of them. But it's great to know that there was, you know, that two things, two polarizing sides of teenagers.
I'm not going to be able to come up with the title, so this is probably not even worth bringing up. But what's the one with Keanu Reeves he made just before River's Edge where he played, where his friend committed suicide off the cliff?
My Own Private Idaho.
No, yes, no. I'm not
I can't remember what
it's
it
not
is.
Not the night before.
Google that synopsis. Yeah. Keanu Reeves, his best mate commits suicide, and then it becomes this teen drama about how his group of friends overcome it.
Yeah,
try to deal with it.
Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Jarrett, you're
okay.
Up.
My last one is this amazing edition the BFI have done in the UK for Lahane.
Oh yes,
The Hate, as it's known in English, but I think maybe in America.
I don't know
it's
anyone
the Hate.
That I don't know anyone that knows it as The Hate.
No, I think maybe the US. You know, I mean they had the American film Pret-a-Porter and they had to title it Ready to Wear, even though it was an American production for an American filmmaker. Incredible debut feature from Matthew.
Here comes a hot stepper.
and Vincent Cassel. And it was just such a, I remember seeing this at the movies, because thankfully I think this was only M, or maybe it was MA actually when it came out. I think it was in year 10 or 11.
Wasn't it R? I thought it was R.
No, it was borderline, because it came out around the same time as Kids.
Okay.
And Kids was R.
Yeah.
And so I was able to see this and it just blew my mind. Mm. Like, it was just poetic, beautiful to watch. And just, yeah, it just, I hadn't quite seen anything like this. Now it's got a 4K restoration from the BFI, and they've loaded it with special features. They've got a booklet. It's
chunky.
Just an amazing addition for the film, yeah. And it looks incredible, because I think it was shot in 16mm. You know, obviously in black and white and whatnot. It just looks stunning. Like, it's a beautiful
what
restoration.
A career that one launched in Vincent Cassel.
Oh, for Vincent Cassel, yeah. I was saying for Matthew Kasowitz, he didn't do too many great films after this. Got that Crimson Rivers was not really the best film to follow.
It was not good. Is that Jean Reno, that one? That's not a great film.
And Vincent Cassel as well. Yeah, and then they did a sequel to it as well.
I think where he fell down is that after that movie, Vincent Cassel signed a deal with the French film industry. That
yes.
He had to be in every French film that was being made.
It was pretty much Gerard Depardieu came out of his contract and they needed the new guy to step in.
Well, Jean Reno, where the fuck was he?
Because he was just pollinating any flower that would take.
He went overseas.
He did just
he
arriving.
Was doing like Ronin and whatever at the time.
Just visiting
the remake. Yeah. Yes. But a startling addition. Like, wow. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's a nice chunky one. That looks great. Do you guys reckon that Adam buys physical media?
He'd have to, wouldn't he? I know he's always talking about things on streaming. Don't tell me he doesn't buy physical media.
Let's find out.
Hey guys, it's Adam here from Adam's Just Seen and Triple M and a couple of other places for our good Movie Monday recommendation. Now this week we are doing movies that we have recently purchased. Now I'm going to jump around that and say that this is a movie that I paid for. I have stopped collecting physical media. It actually really upsets me, but I have lent too many movies away. I have got too many streaming services. I'm just not on top of it the way that I used to. I dedicated basically about half of my life to collecting media, and maybe I'll get back to it. And if I was, I'd be buying the hard copy of this movie that I paid to go and see at the Classic St. Maud. Now, I thought that this is the most incredible horror movie. It messed with me for days. You got Morpheus Clark here, who is playing the titular Maud. He's a carer who is taking care of a dying dancer in a seaside town. And what happens is that we go into a battle of wills between these two characters. There is religious iconography, there is sheer terror, there is twists and turns. It's a mortifying piece and an incredible debut by writer-director Rose Glass. This, just got under my skin in the most kind of incredible way. And I think that, you know, obviously Jennifer Eale playing Amanda here has already arrived, but Morpheus is such an incredible actress that you can't forget her performance in this. It's almost hard to pin down what type of horror this is, because it's like flirting around three or four different subgenres. But I mean, basically, if you're into any kind of horror, you're going to get a kick out of this. Beautifully shot. Yeah, something that will stick with you. Check it out. I like movies now and then that I always try and do this forward guessing thing. And I'm like, how far is this movie going to push? And now and then I see something that doesn't only push now where I think it's going to, but it just kind of kicks the trapdoor out from under me and I go, holy shit, I didn't know it was going to get this wild. This is one of those movies. So 5 stars from me. Check it out immediately.
Adam Ross, chairman of the Australian Film Critics Association. And in case you didn't notice, Triple M and Ticker TV and ABC Radio. And you can find him on Facebook on the Adam's Just Seen page. Always good value. Thanks, mate. So as we enter our final stretch here, I just wanted to give a quick shout out and mention to Simon Sherry, the guy responsible for so much of the incredible artwork and exclusive Umbrella releases, notably the Beyond Genres titles. Simon left Umbrella this week and goes on to other things. And I just wanted to stop and send our regards because he's a friend of the show.
Yes.
He was on one of our early incarnations of the show, the FakeShemp.net podcast. Yeah. So I just want to wish him the best of luck with what he's doing and all the best. So good luck to him. And now we also do a quick whip around of what's playing at the Astor, simply because Astor are friends of ours and support us with some giveaway stuff, which we have coming up. So for those who are not in Melbourne, the Astor is a classic repertoire theatre dedicated to playing classic and cult films, mostly in double bills. So tonight, which is Monday, April 5th, they've got Once Upon a Time in the West at 7:30. Tuesday night, they've got Willy's Wonderland and Jiu-Jitsu at 7:30, which I haven't seen Jiu-Jitsu. Wednesday, Willy's Wonderland again with Mum and Dad. That feels like a much better fit.
That's a better fit.
Yep. Yeah. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at 7:30 each of those nights, they're playing the 35th anniversary of Blue Velvet.
Oh, okay, yeah, yeah. And I think they're playing that off on a film print too, I'm pretty sure too. It might be 35 mil that they're playing.
I would love to see that one on the big screen. And then on Sunday, they wrap the week up with the Maltese Falcon 80th anniversary screening. So
it is, I think, maybe by the time the show drops, they will have announced their next catalogue.
So
we can talk about that on the next show.
Oh, I just want to mention, though, they are going to be doing, I saw this announced, Zach announced it the other day, they're doing a marathon of the Skywalker saga of Star Wars, which means it runs at 20.5 hours. That's amazing they're doing it, but I can't imagine sitting anywhere for that long. I just 20.5 hours, I don't know, I can't.
There are people that will do it.
I know. They do the Lord of the Rings, they do the Hobbit. And the Harry Potter, Harry so nine films, 20.5 hours.
Bring an ass cushion. Achievement.
Yeah, bloody hell. Well, I saw Adam did the Lord of the Rings there at the Astor, and I saw a picture, he took a cushion with him.
Yeah.
Smart decision.
Like a hemorrhoid.
Yeah. Takes you back to the old cinema lock-ins.
Yeah, yeah, I miss that.
So we have a massive bundle of giveaways today. So, as well as an Astor pass, we're also giving away a free pass to the Lunar Drive-In. That's a carload of up to 7 people seated legally. And on top of that, to help you build up your own collection, we have Blu-ray double pack from Umbrella, consisting of Bad Boy Bubby and Blood Vessel. And then we have, thanks to Eagle Entertainment, new releases, Blu-rays of Coma, Skyfire, and Breach to score this banger prize pack. We want you to share your most recent purchases with us on Facebook. So drop us a comment in this episode's post, preferably with photos. The winner will be selected at random, and we'll also award the runners-up with some free movies too. All right, so that brings us to the end. Guys, did you want to have a quick whip through of what else you've purchased recently without too much diversion?
Do the Right Thing on 4K UHD from the US. Universal's released it. It looks stunning.
Amazing film.
Then one I'd recommend is the Hammer Films collection from Mill Creek. It has 20 Hammer films.
I was going to say, what films are in there?
Yeah,
but then you'd have
run
to go
through the title.
20.
The beauty is that it features a lot of the films that are in the indicator sets from the UK, but this will only set you back about $80 as opposed to about $90 a set where you only get 4 films. So admittedly, you don't get any of the special features and you're getting 2 films per disc, so it's a little bit more
compressed. Does that have like some of those really gory sort of 70s ones as
well? No, this is mainly the stuff. A lot of this stuff's the Columbia stuff from the late 50s through to the 60s. This one's going to Netflix on April 14th, Love and Monsters, but I couldn't wait and had to pick it up on 4K. I picked this up. Oh, it must have been in January or so.
I'm dying to watch it.
It's really good. And Australia's Dan Ewing features, and it was shot at the Gold Coast. It's really good. It's been nominated for an Academy Award for Best Visual Effects.
Incredible.
Incredible. And then the last one I just want to plug is Mindwarp. It's just come out on Eureka in the UK.
Who does the commentary on that?
Well, it's funny you say that. It's Tony Timpone from Fangoria, and this guy, I get to moderate the conversation with him. On the back of the cover, it actually does say like a feature length interview with Tony Timpone, which is great. But on the menu, it says a commentary. And I did see one review going, this is just a bloody feature-length interview. And I'm like, well, that's the way they sold it, buddy. but yeah, no, it was really good getting to talk about this movie.
Can you moderate a conversation with one person?
Yeah, I'd just be like, slow it down, buddy. Come on, give it a go. Actually, no, we didn't. It wasn't just him. I might admit that Archie was in the background and he did a fair bit of snoring as well. So there was a lot of editing in that commentary to remove as many snores as possible. Haven't seen one review come out and mention the snoring. So I think we did something right.
It's definitely not something you want mentioned with.
No, Mind Warp out on Eureka. You can get it on Amazon. You get it on Zavvy.
5 snores.
Totally worth it. Yeah.
Ben.
There's a couple more Kenno Lorber classics I picked up. Eye the Jury, it's not like I'm a huge fan of the label, but they are releasing some really good stuff.
They're releasing the stuff that Arrow and, you know, some of the other labels like Criterion and that don't sort of look at because they're not quite that tier of cult classic they're somewhere in between.
Yeah, which I mean,
is great. We're in between kind of guys. We like a lot of these. These are the films that get forgotten otherwise.
I mean, I think these should be. But
yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Arrow sometimes releases stuff. You're like, what are you releasing this for? Like,
Pitch Black.
Like the whole like Arrow Academy line sometimes. You're like,
yeah.
I don't get this.
Yeah.
But anyway, but Eye of the Jury, written by Larry Cohen, based on a Mickey Spillane novel starring Amanda Sante and Barbara Carrera and favorite of mine, Lorraine Landon.
Oh, yeah.
Batshit crazy.
I'd love to hear her talk about that film.
His yeah.
Hey, what do you think? It was only in it.
It is pretty.
What
good.
Else like, you got there?
Super sleazy. Five Grapes to Cairo. Look, it's unfortunate that I picked up the Kino Lorborn actually, because the Eureka one in the UK is jam packed.
Well, that one's still sealed, Ben. You could just put that on eBay and
swap it out. But that is a fantastic movie. It's a Billy Wilder film.
Good stuff.
And Kind Hearts and Coronets, which came out locally through Sony Classics.
There's a whole series, like that label or whatever you call it. Yeah.
Name Busters. Yeah. And, I think I've got.
Interesting. What are your favorites? Don't Look Now.
Don't Look Now.
The Wicker Man. That's on there.
Interesting artwork on those.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very kind of strange pop arty sort of stuff.
Although this actually, I believe, this is actually some of the original artwork anyway. Like, I don't know if that was created specifically for this release, but this is a great one. Alec Guinness plays like it's about this guy who he's kind of been disinherited from his family because his mother married a penniless musician rather than, you know, the thing. And so he's like the 10th in line to inherit this barony. And so in revenge, because they disinherit him and won't let his mother be buried in the family tomb, he decides to bump them off, bump all the 10 people in his way to becoming the thing. And they're all played by Alec Guinness. Like the men, the women, they're like the father, there's a father and son. It's all Alec Guinness.
He was doing Nutty Professor and Norbert
long before
Eddie Murphy. You know.
Yeah.
Well, but it's an Ealing film, and it sits probably like with Lady Killers and Lavender Hill Mob. To quote Keith, it is a stone cold classic. It's a classic of British cinema. It's hilarious. It's still so dark and very funny for a film that was made like what year is it? 1956, earlier?
That's a good question.
Let's just say 50s.
We'll just say sometime in the 50s. For the fact checkers out there.
On the back there?
No, but nothing there.
It's directed by Robert Hamer, who also did School for Scoundrels, the original.
Love School for Scoundrels.
Awesome.
A all-time classic.
The original, not the John Heater, Billy Bob Thornton one. But that was okay. You know, I don't hate it.
Well, guys, that is about it. Jarrett, you should come out and hang out at the desk anytime you want, mate.
Yes, I'll come back.
It's always fun. Ben, you can take a leave it. It's up to you.
Yeah.
No, mate. Yeah. You're worth your weight in gold. Thank you.
That's a lot of gold.
Obligatory thanks to Eagle Entertainment, Umbrella Entertainment, Luna Drive-In, Astor Theatre, and Four Pillars Gin. Thank you for listening, everyone. Please share the show across your social media platforms. Join us on Facebook and YouTube for our midweek video uploads. Definitely make sure that you join us next week, because we have a very special guest, Hollywood director Neil Marshall. Ooh. Who, you know, previously made The Descent and Dog Soldiers. He'll be here discussing his new film, The Reckoning. Shut up, guys. And we'll be leaving you with The Inside Game by Royal Trucks, who are the rat bag scallywags in High Fidelity. It's a movie about collecting shit, so why not? Have a good one, folks. Catch you next week.